the Lord. Me though. Eveth shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though his body be destroyed, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For if we live, we live unto the Lord. And if we die, we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so saith the Spirit, for they rest from their labors.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of thy servant Crawford, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy, in the fellowship of thy saints, through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed and to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from Psalm 91. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked, because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Those who love me I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life I will satisfy them and show them my salvation.
Reading from the Revelation to John. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also, he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. The word of the Lord.
Be God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you.
For those of you that don't know me, I'm Josh Davis, and for those of you that do, you know how much Crawford meant to me. Crawford and I have been best friends since he came to Stratford. Every single one of us in this room was impacted by Crawford some way. Although his life was cut shorter than most, I think it's fair to say he impacted more people than we could hope to impact in our lifetimes. Crawford didn't meet a stranger. He was compassionate, loyal, driven, and relentless. One of the reasons I think Crawford and I shared such a strong bond is because I didn't see Crawford as different. I carried Crawford up many stairs, and yet as we grew older, he grew heavier. Crawford trusted me to carry him without breaking him. Today, I'm faced with the hardest thing I've ever done in my life, and that's carrying Crawford for one last time. I spent the last 2 days in complete shock after I found out about Crawford. I honestly didn't believe it. We had plans. This Sunday, as a matter of fact, I wept. Life without Crawford wasn't something I was able to comprehend. By God's grace, I woke up Tuesday morning with peace. I realized that Crawford never got a chance to run around the track. He never got a chance to catch a long deep ball, catch a long football pass. He never made a layup. I have a clear picture of Crawford catching alley-oops off the glass from Kobe in heaven. I really do. Although Crawford is no longer here with us, he's no longer in pain. We are in pain because he's no longer here, but I talked to Crawford numerous times about his faith, and he knew that when his life ended, he was going to be with Jesus. He would no longer have pain. The suffering would be over. COVID was a very hard time for Crawford. He was so isolated, and I was very concerned about him. We talked daily and played 2K. Something that lifted Crawford's spirits when we decided to start our out-of-sight sports podcast. We were able to work together while recording individually from our houses. One of our podcasts occurred right after the Tiger Woods wreck or accident, and Crawford did an absolutely incredible job speaking about OI and the surgeries and what he thought the future looked like for Tiger. Crawford had a sports mind. He knew just about anything there was to know when it came to Atlanta Hawks basketball and Georgia football. The last few months of Crawford's life, we had a really good time, man. Crawford got to come to Athens to see the Bulldogs win a national title. And you cannot imagine the happiness and celebration with our group of friends. Crawford came up a few weekends later for the Super Bowl. While we didn't agree on who'd win, we had an awesome time, and I lost a good bit of money. But what I want you to know is that Crawford was living life. He was hopeful. He was happier than I'd seen him in a while. I must take a second to thank Mr. and Mrs. Edwards. Your love and devotion to Crawford and your willingness to let him live life was a precious gift you gave to him, and it was a precious gift you gave to everyone that knew him as well. And I thank you so much for doing that. Christine and Millie Parks, Crawford loved both of you very much. I often find myself asking, what would Crawford do? This is something that I did even before he died. It's kind of habitual, and certainly something I will continue to do. I will tell you what Crawford would do. He would get up and live life to the fullest. He would show gratitude for others, and he would better himself in some way every single day. He didn't waste his time complaining. He had every right to be angry. But he wasn't. He wasn't bitter. He just went with what he had and made the most of every opportunity. I'm going to leave you with words from Trey Young, someone that me and Crawford both deeply admired and admire. Another day, another opportunity, and that's exactly how Crawford lived his life. Thank you.
First, I wanted to echo what Josh said, that Crawford meant the world to everyone here, and he touched so many lives more than anyone could hope for. I wanted to share some memories of Crawford, some of my favorite memories. I remember on one of Crawford's first days at Stratford, we were all at recess, and there's a small group of guys talking, and Crawford approached, and I didn't know him yet, but he didn't introduce himself or anything like that. He just joined in on the conversation, and he was so clever, and he added all of his knowledge about whatever video game we were talking about and playing at the time. Soon after that, Crawford became one of my very best friends. I, along with a lot of my classmates, would want to sit with Crawford during carpool. Everyone would beg the teachers to sit with Crawford during carpool, and that's where our friendship really grew. And it grew a lot after that as well. As we grew, our friendship grew. We were able to talk about more serious things, like the things that we loved, the things that made us sad. I was blessed to know Crawford, and one last thing I wanted to share is something about the last time I saw Crawford, 13 days ago. I went to see Crawford, and I didn't get to spend a whole lot of time with him that day, but we sat there and watched the news, and we talked about the war, and we had some really deep conversations, and anyone who knew Crawford knows that that's an easy thing to do. When I had to head out, Crawford said to me, he said, "I'm always a threat." And I said, "What?" And he said, I'm a threat to come crash on your couch any weekend." And I said, "That's not a threat, Crawford, that's a blessing. And he come on anytime, man." I'm gonna miss and love Crawford forever. Thank you.
Those young men did a great job just now talking about Crawford. And I'd like to talk about my friend Crawford. I've known Crawford since he was born, and I've prayed for him every day since. He's an amazing young man, was an amazing young man, who with the help of his family, overcame so many challenges every day. Brown, Christy, Christine, and Millie Parks worked so hard to give Crawford the experiences of a boy growing up in the South. Brown and I share a love of the outdoors, and he wanted to give these experiences to Crawford, and we all wanted to help. Brown and Christy would take Crawford everywhere for a wide variety of experiences. Our part of it was dove hunting, inshore saltwater fishing, and general hanging out. Crawford always had a wonderful can-do attitude about doing these things and spending some time with the guys. As time went on, I had many opportunities to be with Crawford, and inevitably would end up in an in-depth discussion with him about something. I was always amazed at his level of understanding and knowledge of many different things. He also had a sharp wit and a wonderful sense of humor, and we laughed a lot. As usual, with friends, you have little inside jokes. Customs, they're kind of silly, but they're fun. And one of these was about fireworks. I would get with Crawford on 4th of July. We had several opportunities to watch the fireworks. And I would get with Crawford before we started and practice our oohs and our ahs so that we'd be ready. And then we'd throw in a love it, I love it, for good measure. And it was always a great thing, and he thought it was hilarious, so we enjoyed doing that. Another was a nickname for Crawford, and we called him Crawford the Brown. And he said, huh, I don't know about that. I said, well, it has a very regal nature to it, with your Scottish heritage and the times we had. He goes, huh, I think I like that. So we called him Crawford the Brown, and that was a lot of fun. Let me share you a couple of Crawford the Brown stories. I was very blessed and lucky to be invited to Brown and Christie's place on Apalachicola Bay, side of St. George Island in Florida. It became a place where I got to spend a lot of time with Crawford, harassing the local marine life and then marveling at the beauty of it all. When conditions were right, we could catch trout, redfish, and blue crabs right off the dock behind the house. We would put newspaper all over the table, pile the steamed blue crabs on it, and spend time picking lump crab meat and dipping it in a special lemon butter sauce. We had a blast doing that, and he even joined me in a ceremonial sip of the butter to make sure it was just right. Like that. On another trip, the weather was kind of dicey, but we had been out that morning, but had been driven back home by some storms that came up that afternoon. It was June and the weekend of the U.S. Open golf tournament. Crawford and I were watching the golf, and it was the year that Russell Henley was leading the tournament as an amateur. Russ and Crawford were friends, and it was great watching him play. At some point, Brown and Christy and another guest, Lee Limer, wanted to go look at some real estate on the island. Well, I told them I was on vacation, and I would just stay here. And they were starting to ask if I could look after Crawford while they were gone, and Crawford piped up and said, I'll stay here and look after him. Best babysitter I ever had. Okay, one more. This was several years later. Brown had a big blackjack bay boat. It could handle a bunch of people fishing on it. That day we had five. It was Brown, Crawford, Lee, my son Peter, and me. It was late summer, and we were down the bay, down where Government Cut goes through St. George Island. And the bait fish were piled up in the bay side of the cut. It was just everywhere. And there was a top order feeding frenzy all around us. Everybody was throwing into it, and we were hanging up with ladyfish and picking on Spanish mackerel, and it was crazy. And all of a sudden, Crawford was hooked into a big fish. It was a good fish. It fought hard, but so did Crawford. And he kept on, fought that fish as hard as he could as we all cheered him on. He worked it back to the boat, worked it to the net, and in came a huge Spanish mackerel. We were all congratulating him on catching that great fish and how good it would be on the table. Crawford was sitting there looking at that beautiful fish. He was all worn out from the fight, from the excitement. And with a big old grin on his face, he looked up and he said, now I know why men love doing this. It was a beautiful moment. We all agreed. There's no way to put into words everything that Brown and Christy, Christine and Millie Parks did to help Crawford experience life. It's incredible the challenges they all overcame with a spirit of loving support from my friend Crawford. All I can say to them and to you is I have a vision. And that vision is of Crawford right now. A big old strapping young man running around heaven, slam dunking the basketball, and bathed in the grace, love, and glory of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. God bless the Edwards family, and God bless my friend.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts glorify, honor you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a story about Crawford as a very young child that to me is a snapshot of his nature. He'd done something that was naughty, and since you can't spank a child with brittle bones, Christy had put him on a timeout, sitting on the bottom of the stairs, and then had gone on to do whatever she was doing. She came back later than she had planned, having kind of forgotten that he was there, only to find that he had been quite happily entertaining himself, doing a little dance, kind of waving his arms Hawaiian style and singing a little song. The fact that he was being disciplined did not seem to have entered into his mind. As a child, he loved to sing and to dance and to giggle. He was silly and liked to clown around. In spite of all of his hardships, the physical pain and limitations that kept him from being able to run and play like the other children, Crawford had a very sunny nature and was a very happy child. While he had plenty of reason to be discouraged and feel sorry for himself, he never developed a victim mentality or in any way sought sympathy in spite of suffering about 55 broken bones, 28 surgeries, and 60 trips to Montreal for treatments that were often excruciatingly painful. Crawford delighted in engaging with other people. He cherished his friendships with people of all ages, and he had an acute intelligence and insightful nature that enabled him to engage in intelligent conversation with anyone, even at a very young age. He was a people person, and he took great delight in interactions with others. It wasn't that he wanted the attention. It was that he was so interested in other people and had a heart so full of love for them. If someone was struggling with something, he would listen with genuine concern and compassion to their problems, never comparing them to his own. He didn't just want to have friends, he wanted to be a friend to others. Crawford particularly enjoyed watching sports, and he took delight in learning everything he could about his favorite athletes. Not so much just statistics, but things about them as a person and about their lives. He had a deep admiration for their physical prowess and their athletic ability without a trace of jealousy or resentment. He was able to genuinely delight in their success, and he studied their movement as if he were vicariously experiencing what it was to move like that just from watching. He was able to revel in their success and enjoy the way they could move as if he were moving that way too. There's a scripture in Hebrews 12 that says, "Let no bitterness take root in you," warning believers against the destructive poison that bitterness is to a person's soul. Crawford had every reason to be bitter about life, but he was not. That's not the way he chose to live or to see things. He had a purity of spirit, and he saw things through the lens of love. He was a demonstration to us of the joy and blessing that comes when a person who is battling terrible challenges, allows no bitterness to take root in them. His joyful, happy nature was like a magnet. People were drawn to him. So many people knew and loved Crawford. He was Mr. Personality, funny, smart, and a sponge that soaked up knowledge and information. He always had something interesting to talk about, and it wasn't about whatever physical difficulty he was going through at the time. That was not what he chose to focus on. In the sense of Hebrews 12, 1 to 3, Crawford was a track star. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you may not grow weary and lose heart. Crawford persevered to the very end. And that great cloud of witnesses were not only the heavenly host who have received him into glory, but also all of those, all of us, who have been praying for Crawford since he was yet in the womb, who have loved and cherished him and cheered him on, who've been inspired by his faithful, cheerful perseverance. He was truly an overcomer. It wasn't his will or his spirit that finally gave out, it was his body. Now he shares in the resurrection of Jesus Christ and is risen to everlasting life in heaven with the Lord. He has been fully restored to wholeness and a complete and perfect healing. There's no more pain or suffering. He no longer has to wear a beard for people to know he's not a child. I shared your vision, Steve. He will not only have a man's stature, but the maturity he carried within on earth will be revealed. He will go from strength to strength in the life of perfect freedom. Finally, in spite of his clowning around, Crawford was a very deep and serious person, as you've heard, and he embraced mystery. His faith was very important to him and sustained him. His godmother, Katie Tosh, included thistles when she was doing the flowers. You'll see them when you come up for communion. Because Crawford was so proud of his Scottish heritage. But there's an even more important reason to link Crawford with the true thistle. The true thistle has a very deep taproot so that it can hold up against very hostile circumstances. It can thrive in spite of drought or harsh circumstances because it's rooted so deep. Crawford's secret is that for all of his lightheartedness and sunny nature, he was rooted deep. He drew from a deep well that was the Spirit of Christ within him. He was strengthened and sustained by the Lord of life, who has now brought him home to rest. Amen. Please stand. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, who has knit together thine elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of thy Son, Christ our Lord, grant, we beseech thee, to thy whole church in paradise and on earth, thy light and thy peace. Amen. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the grave and gate of death, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Amen. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that thy Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Amen. Grant to thy faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve thee with a quiet mind. Amen. Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in thy fatherly care, that casting all their grief on thee, they may know the consolation of thy love. Amen. Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a reasonable and holy hope, in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. Amen. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Amen. Grant us grace to entrust Crawford to thy never-failing love. Receive him into the arms of thy mercy, and remember him according to the favor which thou bearest unto thy people. Amen. Grant that increasing in knowledge and love of thee, he may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service in thy heavenly kingdom. Amen. Grant us, with all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, to have our consummation and bliss in thy eternal and everlasting glory, and with blessed Crawford and all thy saints, to receive the crown of life which thou dost promise to all who share in the victory of thy Son, Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We seem to give him back to thee, dear God, who gave him to us. Yet as you did not lose him in giving, so we have not lost him by his return. Not as the world gives do you give, O lover of souls. What you give you do not take away. For what is yours is ours always, if we are yours. Life is eternal and love is immortal and death is only a horizon. And a horizon is nothing save the limit of our sight. Lift us up, O God, that we may see further. Cleanse our eyes that we may see more clearly. Draw us closer to yourself that we may know ourselves nearer to our beloved who are with you. And while you prepare a place for us, prepare us for that happy place, that where they are and you are, we too may be through Jesus Christ our Lord. Peace of the Lord be always with you. I'd like to welcome you to Christ Church and to the Lord's table. All baptized Christians, regardless of denomination, are welcome to come and receive communion. If you would like communion, just put your hands out and we will give you the wafer and the wine. Because of COVID, we're not able to use the common cup right now. And if you would like to come forward but for any reason not receive communion, if you place your arms crossed over your chest, you'll receive a blessing. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and on earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. The Lord be with you. And with lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and doth comfort us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to thy faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body doth lie in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And I believe we're using Eucharistic prayer too. Excuse me, let's start that again. All glory be to thee, O Lord our God, for that thou didst create heaven and earth, and didst make us in thine own image. And of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there a full and perfect sacrifice for the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy people do celebrate and make with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make. Having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and with thy word and Holy Spirit to bless and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be unto us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, whereby we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies. Grant, we beseech thee, that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and also that we and all thy whole church may be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we're bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, grant us thy peace. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. The body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. Body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. Body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. Body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. The body and blood of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank thee that in thy great love, thou hast fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and has given unto us a foretaste of thy heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be unto us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all thy saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to thy servant with thy saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. Thou only art immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and unto earth shall we return. For so thou didst ordain when thou createdst me, saying, dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. All we go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to thy servant with thy saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. Into thy hands, O merciful Savior, we commend thy servant Crawford. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech thee, a sheep of thine own fold, a lamb of thine own flock, a sinner of thine own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of thy mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Into paradise may the angels lead thee. At thy coming may the martyrs receive thee and bring thee into the holy city, Jerusalem.